So before we dive in, let's first define what a schema is for a database. So it's essentially going to define the overall structure of the database itself. It's going to contain the table definitions, the columns of each of those tables, the relationships between the various tables itself. Depending on how in-depth your particular structuring diagram application is, it could contain additional information like the particular column type for each of those columns, whether or not they're nullable, whether or not they're unique, so on and so forth. Essentially defining as granular as you want to go the particular definition for your database, specifically for your application. So I've already gone ahead and diagrammed out the database that we're going to be working with throughout this series. I use dbdiagram.io to do this, and this is the output of that diagram. So each rectangle here represents a table. So we have a roles table, users table, watchlist table, crew movies, movies, movie statuses, cinists, and cast movies. Now, cinists is a weird word. I had never heard of it before actually starting out the structure diagram, but if we take a look at the definition of it, it's essentially a filmmaker. It's an enthusiast or a devotee of filmmaking or movies. So it's essentially a single word that we can use to reference crew members as well as cast members so that we can have them all confined within one table, because sometimes you have a director who's also a cast member or a writer who's also a cast member. So they're mix and matchable in that sense. So let's hide our browser back away. So that's what our cinest table is going to contain. It's going to contain our crew members, our cast members. Each crew member is going to have a unique ID. This is going to serve as our primary key. That primary key is a unique identifier for our database, similarly to how we're using the file name within our application at this present point in time to uniquely identify each one of the movies inside our application. But this ID primary key within each of these tables that you see is specific to our database, and our database is going to be in charge of assigning an ID per record that we insert into our database. So we don't need to worry about whether or not an ID is unique. Our database will take care of that automatically for us as we insert each record. It's kind of just going to be an index that starts at one. Each time that we insert a new record, it's going to go from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, so on and so forth, making sure that each one of those records' IDs are unique in each one of our separate tables. So our cinists are going to have an ID, a first name, last name, a headshot URL, which will be a URL for an image of the particular person's headshot they created at, so when they were inserted into the database, and an updated at, so when the record was last updated inside of the database. By default, the created at and updated at, whenever they're first entered, are going to be the same value. And you'll see that the created at, updated at, and ID are shared columns throughout each one of the tables that we have. Our roles, users, watch lists, crew movies, so on and so forth, all have an ID marked with the key here to denote that it is a primary key, and a created at and updated at column, both of type timestamp. You'll also see that the first name, last name, headshot URL, as well as various other columns here within our schema have a varchar with a number inside of parentheses inside of it. The varchar is a database safe type for strings, essentially. And then the number inside of the parentheses is the length that we want to allow. So for example, our first name and last name can be up to but not more than 100 characters. Our headshot URL can be up to but not more than 255. The name for our movie status can be up to but not over 50 characters, so on and so forth. And then for our abstract here within our movie itself, we have a text column type. The text column type is just essentially a really long form version of a string. It's not particularly limited in the sense that our varchars are. And then we have our ints, which our primary keys are, but so too our relationship based information. So like status ID relating to our movie statuses, writer ID going to our cinists, director ID going to our cinists, and so on and so forth. The int type is going to be a number. However, it's going to be a whole number. So 1, 2, 3. It's not going to include 1.1 or decimal-based types like that. It's going to be specifically whole numbers. Okay, so now that we have a sense of everything going on inside of our schema with how we're defining things, let's talk about the actual definition itself for our schema. So we have this split into really two different sections. We have this section down here at the bottom encompassing our movie statuses, movies, crew movies, cinists, cast movies. This is the portion that we're going to be focusing on first in this series. And then we have our roles, users, and watch lists that we'll use within this series to kind of wrap everything up with a bow to cover how you would approach an entire feature within our application here. So these bottom ones are going to be in charge of teaching us how we can define relationships, migrations, models, queries, so on and so forth within our application. And then we'll wrap things up with a bow with our roles, users, and watch lists by covering how we would approach defining those particular features inside of our application. Now, we haven't talked about relationships yet, but you'll notice that each of these tables has a line pointing to and from it. Relationships are defined by taking a records and a table's primary key, so that ID column, and referencing it elsewhere inside of another table. That creates a relationship. Now, there's various different types of relationships. You have one-to-one, one-to-many, or many-to-one, depending on which side of the relationship you're looking at, and then many-to-many as well. And within our schema, these relationships are defined by these lines. So within our movie statuses, our ID for our movie status is pointing to the status ID column on our movie itself, essentially saying that the movie is assigned a status of whatever the value is matching the ID inside of our movie statuses table. So for example, our movie statuses table might have status of released, post-production, production, writing, or various other things like that. So if a movie was released, it might have an ID of 1. If a movie's in post-production, it might have an ID of 2, so on and so forth. So if our particular movie record is released, it's going to have a status ID of 1, matching the released record inside of our movie statuses table. If the movie's in post-production, our status ID would be 2, matching the post-production record inside of our movie statuses table. If you're looking at this from our movie statuses table, this would be a one-to-many relationship, because one record inside of our movie statuses table can have many movies. But if you're looking at this from the movie side, it's going to be a many-to-one, because we can have many movies pointing to one particular movie status. We have the same thing going on with our users and our roles, and our users and the watch list. And our watch list also matches to a movie as well. And then within our movie, we also have a writer ID and a director ID, both pointing to a cinest ID. But we also have a many-to-many relationship between our movies and our cinest as well, denoted via our crew movies and cast movies pivot tables. Pivot tables are intermediary tables. They stand in between the relationship to define what two records go together, in addition to various other information we may need. Particularly, we might have a sort order denoting who the top billed cast member was for the particular movie, so on and so forth, going down the list as such. So for example, if we take a look at our crew movies pivot table here, we have both a cinest ID pointing to one particular cinest member, and then we also have a movie ID pointing to one particular movie. A movie can have many crew members, and a crew member can be a part of many movies. This pivot table is how we can define both of those together. So let's walk through a quick example of our crew movies many-to-many relationship, because this can be a little bit confusing. So we have our crew movies here. We have an ID, our cinest ID, movie ID, and title. For our movies, let's say that we have one with an ID of 1, 2, and 3. And then for our cinests, let's say that we have IDs of 10, 11, and 12. Our many-to-many table here essentially allows us to say that cinest 10 has been a part of multiple movies. So 1, 2, and 3, for example. Cinest 11 might be part of just movies 1 and 2, and Cinest 12 might just be a part of movie 3. So we have Cinest ID of 10, movie ID of 1, maybe their title for this was writer, and then we would have Cinest 10 on movie 2, maybe they were somebody's assistant or something for that movie, and then we would have Cinest 10 on movie 3, maybe they were a writer again. Each of these records would get a unique ID, so we'd have 1, 2, and 3 there. And so with this, we've defined that Cinest number 10 has been a part of movies 1, 2, and 3. Conversely, we've also noted that movie 1 has a cast member of Cinest 10, movie 2 has a cast member of Cinest 10, and movie 3 has a cast member of Cinest 10. And with each of these, we've assigned that Cinest their unique role for that particular movie of writer, assistant, and writer. Now for Cinest 11, they were only a part of two movies, so we can add in our IDs of 4 and 5. Our Cinest 11, they were in part of 1, maybe they just got coffee, and then on movie 2, maybe they got the bagels. So in addition to Cinest 10, we've now also defined that Cinest 11 has been a part of movie 1 and movie 2, and their various roles for those two movies. And now we also have the flip side of that, where movie 1 now has two different cast members. They have both Cinest 10 and Cinest 11. So our many-to-many table really just allows us to mash together two different tables to say that they both relate to one another, and we can define additional information on how they specifically relate to one another as well. If how these tables relate to one another isn't quite making sense yet, don't worry, that's still a good step away. We have to define everything first within our application, get our actual tables created along with all of their columns, get data inside of each one of those tables, and then we can start to look at how they relate to one another. So we're going to step through it step by step. So if things aren't quite making sense yet, don't fret, we'll get there.